I've played this song a couple of times, but it is one of the most beautiful ones. This particular version is of this hymn, which I learned as a 5-6-year-old in an Anglican elementary school, is brought to us by a really cool cat, if you want a jazz expression, from the 50s and 60s. And my wife reassured me that this is the only version of this particular song that you should ever play. So please sing along with Morning Has Broken. And a little bit later in the sermon, perhaps you relate to the reason why I chose to share this one with you.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the spring. Fresh from the world. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the season of the dark times, strumming the deep where the deep mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one night, Eden softly. Praise it elation, praise every morning, God's recreation. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the screaming, fresh from the world.
As I mentioned, I learned that hymn as a 5-year-old, and it's still the most beautiful song and the most beautiful thought. And we're going to be reading today, a little bit later. Sometimes you bury the lead, but I get back to the Morning Is Broken a little bit later. But today we're going to be reading a passage from the book of Philippians. And the Revised Common Lectionary that our congregations around the world are following, more or less right now, directs us there. We've been in the book of Romans, and we come to this little section of scripture. And as I take the challenge of being asked, read this, think about it, and find out how it speaks to you, I am encouraged. I know that when I was growing up, it was not unknown for comedians to mock the Anglican community, which followed the Revised Common Lectionary. And always the pontification was, my text for the day is, and it was assumed it would be followed by a 10 to 15 minute homily that would put you to sleep after about 35 seconds. I was speaking to a friend of mine who pastored with us in Forest in Canada up until about 10 years ago, and he's retired now and lives in, of all places, Leipzig, Germany. And he's very fluent in French. He pastored in the French churches in Montreal and Quebec City, worked for us in Geneva, Switzerland for some years. And now, of course, he knows German very well. His wife speaks German. And he is living in Leipzig, and he's part of an Anglican community. And he was reassuring me how inspiring it was to worship together with others and to hear his local pastor, his local vicar, or whatever the title may be these days, give such solidly based, scripturally sound sermons during these difficult times. And I thought, well, that's exactly what we want to know, what we want to hear. I know I've had the pleasure of performing three weddings for my three nieces. And I've participated in Anglican worship services in that context in a 1,000-year-old church in the village of Pucco Church. Look it up. It really is a village. And it really is an old, old church. But there I am, realizing Christian heritage has informed this building for 1,000 years. And this erudite individual who is a graduate of Cambridge University and is serving in a small parish, was an officer in the British Army for some years, is a devout Christian and sincerely and such with solid devotion to the scriptures brings ministry to that little village. So when I refer to the Revised Common Lectionary and my text for the day, I refer to that in that particular context. I'm inspired and moved by the words of Paul. He writes the book of Philippians. It's a letter that he writes from a prison cell to a congregation that he wants to encourage. And if you think about that, where does he get the strength, the will to encourage other people when everything that gives him meaning and purpose in life has been stripped away? He lives to travel. He lives to evangelize. He lives to plant churches. He lives to talk to other people about the gospel. And as he does this, he is, even when he sits still for a couple of years in Corinth, it's because it's a port city and people are coming and going. And everybody he talks to, where are you off to? Well, I'm off to Rome, or I'm off to some other place in the empire. I'm off to Carthage in North Africa, maybe. He says, well, I want you to carry a message. I want you to carry a thought with you. Think about the promised Messiah. Oh, okay. Wasn't thinking about him, but I want you to think about it. And then the debate begins and the discussion. And by the time they leave him a few days later, they've been infected with this virus, if I could appeal to the pandemic metaphor, this virus of truth that they're going to carry with them wherever they go. And that's why he, even though he sits still in Corinth, he sits still for a reason and he accomplishes the purpose. And this individual who I liken to a soaring eagle who swoops here and there to deliver this good news of the gospel is confined to a prison cell. He can't talk, he can't evangelize. And yet in the midst of what I think you would agree is a pretty discouraging circumstance for him, he writes a letter to the Philippians to thank them for a little gift that they sent to him and to encourage them. That's why Philippians is sometimes called the happiest book in the Bible. So we're going to go to the happiest book in the Bible, and we're going to read a passage of scripture, and we're going to see what it has to say to us today. Think of this as the happiest book in the Bible. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I don't know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it's more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come to see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one faith, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, that they will be, and that you will be saved, and that by God. For it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, since you're going through the same struggle you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. It's pretty heavy language, which is common for Paul. He may have well have conducted dictated this particular letter, and quite often his words are a little lengthy, and his verbiage is quite profound. But nonetheless, you get the message. He is positive. He is inspired. He is encouraged. And he is, in this particular section, talking with great clarity. And so the question is, well, what can we learn from that? How can we learn from that? How can we find ourselves in these words, encouraging how he happens to be writing the happiest little book in the Bible, while he is facing what we would confess to be a really, really challenging circumstance? There is a prevailing philosophy today that's characterized by this little picture of a woman in frustration trying to make a decision. The philosophy is called broadly existentialism. And before I go too much further, let me just give you a working definition of existentialism. Existentialism purports that there is no meaning to life. There is no purpose for life. We are a little blob of flesh and blood parked on a rock that's hurtling around the sun, third rock from the sun. And the only purpose for your life, the only meaning to your life, is that which you choose to give it. And in choosing to give it, you can give it whatever meaning you like. Now, this poses a few intellectual problems, you know. Currently, there's a bit of a debate, in fact, a lot of a debate. I was talking to somebody yesterday who was conducting a business meeting by Zoom. Zoom, by the way, which we're using right now, is for business meetings. That's why it's not very good with music. I don't know how the music was on your receiving end today, but it was kind of cranky or a little bit sluggish. That's why we'd like to switch to Facebook, and that's why we're asking your cooperation. But yeah, back to the point. Here he is on a Zoom meeting, and he's negotiating a software contract with a company in Europe. He's networking with a partner in England. Here he is in Canada. And at one particular point, as they're moving through the discussion, the screen changes, and on comes a very, I'll use the expression, masculine-looking woman who immediately poses the question out of context and out of the blue, what are your programs for diversity? What are your programs for gender equality? What are your programs for? And so he's answered truthfully, well, we don't have any structured programs for these things. But what I'm saying to you is that we're an equal opportunity employer. And if somebody is experiencing roadblocks, hurdles to their personal progress, if their effectiveness is hindered because of something, we'll move, you know, heaven and earth to try to get those hindrances out of the way. We don't operate from the point of view. And he might as just as well have said, you know, we'll do everything we can to promote an individual who's willing to promote the business. And that's the way they work. It's a multinational company, and it's to their benefit to make sure everybody, no matter what their persuasion, their orientation, gets an opportunity to contribute to the success of the company. Now, you bring that a little bit further in, and you begin to understand that there's a controversy about, let's say, gender identity, something I never expected to hear about in my lifetime. But I have a daughter, was a teacher. I have other connections in other directions. And people tell me that today, unlike my limited understanding, where there are two sexes, male and the superior one, it's a little humor I threw in there, you know, male and female, okay? Because we all know God made man first. And then we know that he scratched his chin and said, you know something? I think I can do better. And then he made woman. But of course, we understand humanity is a reflection of God himself. We're in the image and likeness of God. He invested many of his qualities in men. You know, prejudice says the important ones. And then the leftover ones he invested in women. But you understand that together we form a union. When God sees a couple, he says, they are one. Male and female created he them. And he invested himself in the two sexes, male and female. Now, today, you are welcome to identify your gender in numerous ways. And I won't even begin to list them, but I have heard lists that go as high as 30 and 40 alternatives. Which box do you want to check? Well, I want to check the one that says M for male. And my wife wants to check the one that says F for female. And kind of that's as far as I can think, but you know, gender identity is something that is a little different than your sexual identity or your biological identity. And if you want to vest your life with a different meaning, it's up to you, says the existential philosophy. And this is where it's playing out. And so this has become part of, let's say, the underlying curriculum, the underlying social structure in the school environment. And now this then leads to the next question. Well, if a child doesn't want to be him, her, simply wants to be them, well, they should be entitled to participate in gender reassignment surgery to sort of line things up a little differently. Okay, gender reassignment surgery. Who gets to make that decision? Well, it's the decision the individual makes. Okay, they're choosing their meaning and their identity in life. And so the next question is, are they entitled to make that assumption at the age of 10, 11, 12, 13, 14? And there are those who would argue, yes, absolutely. And if you as a parent do not give them that freedom, you're hampering their choice of identity and purpose in life. Okay, I had a discussion some time ago with a man who felt that, well, once my kid is out of school at 18, he's on his own, he can make his own way. So being cantankerous so-and-so, I said, well, you realize that he's going to need post-secondary education. Well, that's his problem, not mine. Well, you realize you're responsible for post-secondary education up to the age of 23. The blood drained from his face and he was angry. Nobody can tell me I have to pay the bills for this kid until he's 23. When he's 18, he stands on his own, 2 feet. No, the law says that you have to pay for his education until he's 23. He's quite indignant. That's what the law says. He is under your protection, your care, your medical protection, your medical program, your educational sponsorship until he's 23. But at 11 or 12, he's entitled to perhaps make a decision that is major. Now, I have talked to numerous parents over the years, and I have been privy to situations where individuals have identified themselves as being perhaps gender confused and attracted in areas that I personally, as a conservative Christian, might say, well, that's not exactly why God created sexuality. Okay, and I'm not sitting in judgment. I'm just saying that, well, you know, that's not what I understand God's purpose for sexuality to be. At which particular point, if they were free to make a decision, we might hear something happening to them. And then 3 or 4 years later, I've been aware, well, what's happened? Well, they've changed their mind. Well, what happened? Well, they grew through that particular area, that time in their life where they were fascinated by something and thought they wanted to go in a particular direction. And now they're sort of growing and going in a different direction. Okay, their attractions have changed because, you know, a teenager is constantly on the change and on the move and facing life. And so I give you this long explanation to simply state that existential philosophy, where you have to define your life and have your own sense of meaning and purpose, cuts you off from anything that's greater, anything that's more meaningful than just me and mine and that which is for myself. And here Paul has been cut off from all that is me and mine and for himself. And so he is frustrated. No, he's not. He is actually writing the happiest book of the Bible. And as I speak about existentialism, you know, I can refer to one of the Greek proponents of this philosophy in the 20th century, Jean-Paul Sartre. He left us in 1980. He was a French intellectual, philosopher, obviously an atheist. And he said this: man is condemned to be free, because once thrown into the world, he is responsible for everything he does. He is condemned, he says. His freedom can be liberating, or it can be dominating. It can be oppressive, just as we saw that poor woman agonizing over what am I supposed to say, what am I supposed to choose, what am I supposed to do? Because if it's all about me and that which I'm experiencing, well, it becomes difficult. Sartre wrote a play, which is kind of a satire in a way, called No Exit. And it has individuals who are living in a room, and they are ushered in by a valet, and they ask for what is beyond the room. Is there something bigger than this room? Well, beyond the room, the vague answer is there's a passageway. Well, what's beyond the passageway? Well, there is another room. And what's beyond that room? Well, more rooms. You'll discover if you ever walk down that passageway and find that room. And of course, the vague answers are frustrating. And so these people are trapped inside this room, and basically they drive each other crazy. And so this is what he means by you're condemned to be free. You're condemned to agonize over your choices. On the other hand, what is happening to me then in this circumstance is I'm a victim. I am adrift. I'm unable to function. Well, it would help if there was something greater than me that had more authority, that had more a greater definition of truth. If there was something outside of me that was above me and beyond me. Paul knows this to be true. In fact, this little section, we could go at some length through it, but he's going to explore a couple of truths: true freedom and true perspective. We could perhaps spend a lot more into this section, but then I'd have to talk for the rest of the day, and you wouldn't enjoy that. In fact, you'd start to get pretty tired. So let us look at a moment at some of the things that we are learning here, where Paul says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Either way, I win." Well, okay, there's no downside to what happens to you. You're not a victim. No. Either way, my life is hidden in Christ. My life is defined by the purpose for which my Creator made me. I am not an accident. I did not evolve. I'm not a lump of flesh hurtling through space on the third rock from the sun. I am, and this is where we begin to understand. I mean, I've had the sad experience of asking young people who've lost a parent, "Do you believe you'll ever see your mom again?" "No, my mom is a warm feeling. My mom looks over me." I don't know how she does that if she no longer exists, but anyway, she looks over me, metaphorically speaking. She is the inspiration and the spirit to me. She was a lovely person, but I'll never see her again. Really? You know, my wife, I'm sure, I know for a fact, rejoices to think that her dad, who was a wonderful man, she will see him again. Her mom, who was a wonderful person, she will see her again. That all that those individuals were is preserved by the God who made them for a purpose. And this is where a liberal or an existential philosophy brings grief and agony to individuals. How do you make sense of the death of a child? How do you make sense of the question, should I live or should I die? Well, Paul says, if I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? And of course, he doesn't really have a choice. You know, he can't choose to die and be with Christ. That is God's timing. He's not permitted to take his own life. He's not permitted to lie down and say, I think this is the end of it. Rather, he is saying this in an odd sort of way, as far as we might say. Let's say we might say, well, what should I wish for? What should I hope for? He says, you know, I do not know. All right. And of course, you don't know. You don't know the day of your appointment with Jesus Christ, our Savior. And so he says, I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. So, yeah, but it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Either way, I'm a winner, he says. We're fond of hearing the expression, perhaps, everything happens for a reason. But the fact of the matter is we comfort each other with that expression, but we don't know the reason. And it rings rather shallow if there's no individual who can bring victory out of defeat. If there's no one who can bring beauty out of the ashes, if there's no one who can lift you up and say, your suffering is not in vain. And yet Paul has that, something greater than himself. He is not floundering. He is not lost. And he understands the reason for his life. That's a restlessness that we all feel. And that restlessness reflected in Jean-Paul Sartre's expression, you're condemned to be free. You know, you have the burden of choice, buddy. And of course, Nietzsche put it in his philosophy, whatever it doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Well, okay, sometimes that is a helpful phrase. Boy, this is a tough thing. Don't worry about it, Bob. Whatever kills you makes you stronger. If you happen to be at a football practice, what do you hear? Suck it up, princess. You know, this is going to be good for you in the final analysis. But in the greater scheme of life, you know, I remember seeing Rocky Balboa, you know, Sylvester Stallone interviewed many, many years ago, and he had a son who was autistic. And he was asked, you know, and I know people who have children who are perhaps a little less than we might hope for them. Maybe Down syndrome, or maybe they have a challenge in their life, as my cousin did, Andrew. You know, smitten with meningitis at the age of 6 weeks, and for the rest of his life, you know, physically challenged, died early because of that. And so Sylvester Stallone said, you know, this is not a hidden blessing. This is not a mixed blessing. There are no positives to this. It takes energy. It takes strength. There's no hope in this situation. There is nothing but defeat, is what he was saying. And yet, out of the ashes of defeat, our Lord often brings victory in the here and now. Out of the ashes of defeat, he promises us victory in the future. And so this is not Paul saying, well, I'm a Hamlet, to be or not to be, that is the question. This is, in fact, Paul saying, you know, I really don't have any choice here, but what do I hope for? And either way, either thing I hope for, I will be victorious because Christ is bigger and stronger than all these. But this is the way he answers the restlessness of his heart. Augustine of Hippo, acknowledge you have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it rests in you. That's the difference between living with me and only me and living with Christ. You know, we try to fill our lives with the things that we enjoy, and there are many examples that we could appeal to here. A quick pop quiz here for you. Who is the last queen of France? Okay. This is a bonus question, and we'll leave the major exam for the end of the sermon. But the last queen of France, you remember who she was? Yes, you do. It was Marie Antoinette. Let them eat cake. Okay, they don't. The peasants don't have bread. Well, let them eat cake. Okay, if you're ever privy to the lifestyle that she had, it was extravagant. It was incredible. That's why they had a revolution. You know, it was a bad thing to watch the way she overindulged herself. And you look at the diet that she feasted on, what she had for breakfast, and then what she ate during the day, all these exotic delicacies. You know, she never had porridge for breakfast. Let's put it that way. She never had soup and a sandwich for dinner. You know, and yet, amidst all the wealth and all the indulgence and all the sycophants that surrounded her, when she sat down to eat, she famously said this: "Nothing tastes. Nothing tastes." In our scriptures, there was another individual who started life on a decent footing, acknowledging that God was the one who had vested in him the responsibility to rule the chosen people of Israel. And he asked for wisdom. That wisdom is reflected in that very famous story of the women who came to him and said, "Wow, you know, this is my child." "No, this is my child." And he asked the guard with a sword, "Chop it in two so they each have a half." And of course, this is the legend that spreads the fame of this very wise king to the rest of the world. Because one woman says, okay, wait, give it to her. That must be the woman. That must be the woman who loves the child. Well, Solomon ages, he drifts away from the one who gives him purpose and meaning in life. It tells us that he has 700 wives and 300 concubines. Now, not to get too far down this rabbit hole, but you have to remember that numbers are very important in Hebrew text. And so when it says 700, it means, you know, yes, a nice round figure here, not the wives, the number. 300 concubines, you add that together, you have 1,000. And if you want to communicate in Hebrew, the matter of what's happening, you know, if you say this individual is out of control, or if you want to say God's mercy is infinite, it goes to 1,000 generations. If you want to say you're going to be conquering your enemies, 1,000 shall fall at one hand, 10,000 at the other, things like that. So when it says he has 700 wives and 300 concubines, it says there is no limit to his indulgence of the flesh. And as time goes by, of course, he loses perspective and he loses the grip on reality. And as he loses grips on reality, he writes this in the most famous of his books, Ecclesiastes: utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. Nothing tastes. You bring beautiful women into my company and seeing one, seeing them all. What a horrible thing to have to say. What a horrible place to be in life. And yet this is the futility. Now, I talked about mourning is broken a while ago. And one thing you cannot really avoid right now is yesterday and today for the Jewish community is the celebration of what? Rosh Hashanah. The blowing of trumpets. Yesterday on the Hebrew calendar was the official festival of trumpets. And it's celebrated actually for 2 days in the Jewish community. And it depends on who you read, but there's some sort of mystery to the meaning of the Festival of Trumpets. And I'll just give you a little thumbnail sketch. God gave Israel festivals in the spring, okay? And of course, those remembered and celebrated the way the nation came into being. We were delivered from the mud pits of Egypt, where we worked 7 days a week. We were brought out, we were given a day of rest, the shop steward gave us a day off, you know, this sort of idea. And this identified us, people who found freedom in their relationship with their God, found rest in their relationship with their God. Their God was not a slave driver like all the other gods. Their God was merciful and compassionate. compassionate, and he loved his people. Then the other festival, you know, they're drawn towards Sinai, and there they make a covenant. And interestingly enough, when they are drawn to the mountain, it says they hear the voice of God. And what does the voice of God sound like to the people? It sounds like a trumpet. God's voice calling his people sounds like the blast of a shofar. A penetrating blast that says, hey, pay attention. I am the God who created you. I'm not saying that as they approached the Mount Sinai that they literally heard his voice. Hey, you people, I'm God. Come here. They saw on the mountaintop thunder and lightning and cloud, and it was a fearful thing. And they heard this blast of a trumpet, which was the voice of God to them. And as they heard that voice of God, they were drawn to the mountain. And then, of course, they came to a certain point and said, Moses, you go up and talk to him directly. Come down and tell us what he said. Now, in the fall of the year, you have 4 days appointed. The Festival of Trumpets, the Day of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, and then a Festival of Booths. And this recapitulates the same story. It begins with, I am God calling you, the blast of the trumpets, and then 10 days of reflection. And in the Jewish community, there will be now 10 days of reflection. This will be day two. And they will be considering in their particular theology, their sins and their shortcomings and their failings. And they will sort of be thinking of rearranging their life, reflecting about how they can be again reconciled to God. And then, of course, on day 10, because 10 is a significant number, on day 10 is the day of reconciliation, the day of atonement. And on that particular day, of course, the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies, carry the people on his breast, on his heart, and he in himself, he would mediate between God and mankind, and they would be reconciled in this, actually, this cube that was the Holy of Holies. And then followed shortly after a celebration of abundance, because God has blessed us with a harvest. We have the fatted calf. We have all of the wheat and the grains that are brought into the barn. We have the fruits. We have the vegetables. We have the wine. Of course, it takes a while for wine to ferment. But, you know, we have next year's wine here, and we can drink last year's wine in this celebration. And we will think about what during this festival of booths? We will think about the time that we spent in the wilderness with our God. Our God, who said to us, here you are in a wilderness, but I will nourish you. I will protect you, not just by having your shoes wear out, but I will feed you from heaven, the bread of heaven that came down, the manna, the water of life that came out of a rock. Wow, these miracles in a wilderness that sustained his people. And so this cycle of festival, and I reference it because, of course, yesterday was Rosh Hashanah, and we are in now into this festival season, the first 21 days of the seventh month. And, of course, in Jewish thinking, this day, which is the first, yesterday was the first day of the seventh month, and as such, it was a festival day that was declared that God was the one calling them into assembly, getting their attention with the blowing of the trumpets to symbolize his voice. And in addition to that, of course, the king would be in his reign on this particular day. There were different ways of counting the king's reign, but he was declared upon this particular day. And they were established as a people by this particular day, and they responded to God's voice on this particular day. And so this is what we have: the blast of a trumpet calling your attention to the God who is your creator, who created you for a purpose, who has vested your life with meaning. And as you go through your trials and your tribulations and your victories, and especially your victories, you might want to think about And so it is this time of the year that the priests would bring the people before them. And what did they instruct the people? How did they instruct the people? Well, they took the book of Ecclesiastes that explained through Solomon's experience that whatever you gather to yourself, the abundance of this season that you are now concluding, the abundance of all of the blessings God gives you, without God, without this greater identity in your life, without this greater purpose, without this overarching meaning, without this sense not that you're just a bundle of flesh twirling around the sun, but rather you understand that you are living on a timeline, that the God who is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, this God who says, I am the beginning and the end, also says you have a start somewhere. And you started somewhere, and you are in a lineal progression going somewhere, and you are going to end up somewhere. And the end of your journey will be with your creator God, who created you for a purpose and is even now blasting on a trumpet, or, you know, to put the metaphor aside, speaking loudly and asking you to pay attention to the real purpose for your life. This is what Paul is saying to us. This is what he's celebrating. And we are not, in this particular point, Marie Antoinette saying everything is tasteless. We are not condemned, as Sartre said, to just suffer freedom and all the uncertainty that brings. You know, as Jesus himself said, so if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. In other words, your freedom belongs in your identity and your understanding of God's purpose for you as revealed in his Son, Jesus. That's how you're going to relate to God. And so Paul declares, for me to live is Christ, and to die is also gain. I can't lose if I understand my purpose and my meaning in life. I will not be condemned, all right, this time of harvest festival to say nothing tastes. Rather, as the priest will instruct me, you know, you have an abundance, enjoy it. And that was one of the great lessons, of course, of the Festival of Tabernacles or the Feast of Booths. Look back and realize, even in deprivation, water flows, bread is provided. And so that is why Solomon, towards the end of his life, reflects on what it is to live so far from God, the frustration, the agony, the misery that he endured, to where nothing is any beautiful. I've had this countless number of consorts, and he made a lot of political alliances, let's put it like that. If you're married to a daughter of the king of Syria, or the daughter of this town up north, you really don't want to go to war with your father-in-law or your brother-in-law. And so that's the way they made alliances. And if you get bored with your wives, you're going to have X number of concubines. You see an attractive woman here in a village somewhere. Just have her come to serve at the palace, okay? And we'll see what we can formalize as an arrangement, you know? So in some ways, he was a polygamist. And in some ways, he was just Hugh Hefner. And at the end of that particular experience, he says, now all has been heard. Here is the conclusion of the matter. Fear God. He's bigger than you. Or in other words, respect your creator. Keep his commandments. Listen to what he has to say to you. And define your life accordingly. For this is the duty of all mankind. It's ironic as we think of this season of the year, which is being celebrated within the Jewish community. They also say that, and of course this is a mythology, you can't prove this, but the legend is, the thinking is, it is on the day of Rosh Hashanah. It is on the Feast of Trumpets that God created man. And that's why I think my mind went to that beautiful hymn, Morning Has Broken, like the first morning. Because in that story, there was a first morning. There was a wonderful opportunity for man to walk and talk with the Father in heaven. And to understand that I am God, I made you, I have a purpose for you, and everything around here is made for you. But by the way, don't touch that tree. In other words, don't make decisions based on your sense of purpose and identity and what speaks to you. Ask first, what did my Creator make me for? How can I live a fulfilling and rewarding life, even if I find myself in a prison cell? You get the point? You understand what God is saying? Listen to the trumpet. Listen to the voice of God. This is how you find true freedom, not the freedom that Sartre said. You're free to do whatever you want. No, you are free to find the definition for yourself within Christ. That's why Paul is emphasizing that and saying, either way, if my definition of freedom is in Christ, then either way I win. And so then he adds to this, convinced of this, this is the second point we're making, I know that I will remain and I will continue with all of you. Why? For your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. So this is how his perspective is defined and changed now. He also declares, because he doesn't know the real outcome of everything here, whatever happens, that's my perspective. It happens for a reason. Whatever happens, it's within God's purpose. Whatever happens, it's so that God's purpose can be accomplished. So, yeah, we do accept that we see through a glass darkly, and we do not know and see and understand everything that's before us. Whatever happens, he says, so conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one faith, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. And there are a lot of things and there are a lot of people who will oppose you. We talked about it in church life. I prayed for it. The conclusion of church life. We have people who are underemployed. We have people who can't find jobs. We have people who are pressed upon. We have a population now in Alberta looking forward to, no doubt, a hike in taxes, a limitation of benefits. We are pretty well stressed out right now. We are assaulted from one side and the other. I'm talking just about, you know, the community of Alberta, which I care about because I live here and everything affects me. But we are also talking about individually and what you and I experience day by day as we face the setbacks and the triumphs. How do you cope with success? How do you cope with abundance? I went to a concert some years ago, and Elton John was performing. And, you know, he's English, but don't hold that against him. But Elton was talking about, and he's had a really messed up life. I think you might know that. You can enjoy his music, but you can't afford to admire what he's been through or what he does in his life. But he said at one particular point, he said, success is just as challenging and oppressive and hard to cope with as failure. And I reflected upon that because this is what the book of Ecclesiastes is saying to the chosen people of Israel. Listen. You got an abundance here. You're really living well. And then we're going to read you the story of David's, you know, David had a tough life. He died at 70 and he was well worn out. Solomon had an abundant life and he was worse off than his dad ever was. And they were reminded during this festival, you remember when our forefathers dwelt in the wilderness? God fed them from heaven and watered them from a rock. And of course, we are fed from heaven by the bread of heaven, Jesus, our Savior. And we are watered from heaven. It was on the last day, I believe, of this entire cycle of Israel's festivals that Jesus stood up and said, hey, come to me. I'll not only make sure that you have water of life, but the water of life will flow through you to other people. Wow, what a concept. And so in Christ, we enjoy these things. Okay, whether you're opposed by others or you're victorious. In fact, he's going to say, your life is a sign to them who maybe oppose you or put you down, and every now and then you have that, that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God. Why? Because it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him. And he's talking about the immediate circumstances in Philippi. They were going through some tougher times, not near as tough as Paul had gone through, but he said, you know, remember I had difficulties when I was there with you? Well, you are having some difficulties now. But also to suffer for him, since you are going through the same struggle you saw I had and here that I still have. In other words, his problems and difficulties were enormous. He was in prison and he couldn't do anything that he rejoiced to do or had been called of God to do. And yet he was victorious. We are called upon to reorient our lives and to perceive the purpose and the meaning that God has given to us in those lives. We have answered the trumpet call. We have answered the blast of the shofar that is the voice of God calling us. And we've lived through that phase of repentance and understood that we've been reconciled to our Father in heaven. We have experienced atonement. And we are now living out that experience of tabernacling with God, living with God, journeying with God. And sometimes you may feel like it's a wilderness, literally, that Israel went through. And so as I couldn't help but reference this, since yesterday, as I was speaking, it was Rosh Hashanah. And you can't help but reference this, of course, because most of us understand this background from the Old Testament. And it's on the news. It's around us. The Jewish community is celebrating these things. But this is where they find their fulfillment, do they not? In Jesus the Christ, who is the bread of life, who is the water of life to each and every one of us, and who walks with us, yea, even through the wilderness. The wilderness Paul has found himself in, which was his prison cell. It's my joy to read these scriptures to you today and to share them with you, but also to remind you that, let's face it, like Solomon, we all hold certain things dear to ourselves. We're all attracted to certain things. We're all motivated by certain things. Can't help it. It takes the mind of Jesus, our Savior, within each and every one of us to reorient ourselves towards the purpose and the meaning of life that has flowed out of our relationship and our understanding that our Creator loves us and created us for his pleasure and created us to know the pleasure of knowing him. We're going to conclude with a song of worship. You're muted, so you're invited to sing along. And after that, we'll close with prayer.
All I once held dear, build my life upon all this world. You're my joy, my
Well, before we close in prayer, I did get a text from Ray Starr. Said mom was recovered slightly, recognized him, is able to communicate. So a little bit of good news, a little bit of comfort for the family. I wanted to share that with you. And if you have the number and if you'd like to communicate with Ray, I passed on my best wishes and my message, and he related to mom. And I hope you're able to do the same. Let's bow our heads together at the conclusion of our worship service. Our Father in heaven, today we are most grateful that we can come together by this means of electronic communication. We can at least share the same music, share the same inspiring words from your Bible. We can feel your presence and understand your care for each and every one of us. We bring our petitions quietly before your throne of grace, and we offer them. We think of our loved ones. Most of all, we thank you today for your community, your blessing upon us, and the time that we've been able to share together. So we thank you and ask now that you bless our visiting time, our fellowship together, and you bring encouragement and strength to each and every one of us. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.